It was only December 15th, and all my shopping was done, all the presents were wrapped, and holiday baked goods were waiting in the freezer. All I had to do was lie back and rest in the hospital bed. I surveyed the room full of flowers and thanked myself for having the forethought to get ready for Christmas ahead of the surgery, and at the same time gently chastised myself for being so glib. I'd fallen right into the usual cancer patient mode of thinking, that only happens to other people, and surely not me, a 35-year-old wife, mom, and teacher. Those things just don't happen. They'll wake me and tell me it was just a cyst or something. Well, they didn't. Instead, they woke me and they told me it was a 2-centimeter tumor in my breast with tumors in half my lymph nodes. Merry Christmas to me. My eyes fell on the one floral arrangement that symbolized the reaction I had received from friends and family. Breast cancer in a young woman, especially in those days, usually caused friends and family to react in one of two ways. Either they cut and run, or they sent a floral arrangement big enough to be entered as a float in the Rose Parade. This floral had to have left all the Hawaiian islands completely stripped of vegetation. The number of poinsettias in the room seemed to express special feelings of regret that this terrible thing had happened during this season of joy. The saving grace is the precious handful of friends who stick by you. My friend Judy, who is a pastor with the face and spirit of an angel, visited and in 3 minutes said enough to help me reconcile the joy of Christmas with the grief of cancer. After that, I kept the vision of these two specters holding hands. The ghost of ghastly cancer helped me to more deeply greet the spirit of Christmas joy. Our Christmas that year was a curious mix of mood, joyous and somber all at once, with lots of forced smiles and awkward hugs. Sister and family had traveled through an ice storm to be with me. Every scripture reading and a service was loaded with additional meaning, and every Christmas card, even the corny ones, caused a couple of tears. But thank God for the small tasks of life, the errands that must be run, the ball games that must be played, the homework that must be supervised. That's the work that keeps you exhausted when you want to rest, but it is also the work that keeps you in the mainstream of your life. Soon after the holidays, I started chemotherapy. I remembered that in younger days, I had thought, upon seeing melodramatic films with heroines facing cancer, I would forego that difficult treatment and just die. When faced with both alternatives, it was much easier to face the prospect of bloating, nausea, and lost hair rather than early death. Those dramas usually had the heroine jetting off to the Paris she always wanted to see, or embarking on a journey to check off humanitarian deeds she must do before she dies. The reality, I learned, is that you have to buckle down, reserve your energy, and not take chances with injury before you begin treatment. And you have to save your money. Disease does not provide such a glamorous or easy escape. I'd read brochures about general chemotherapies, the importance of taking in more than the normal count of calories to avoid weight loss. So I had permission, I thought, during the holidays to pack it on. It would be just my luck that I would get the wrong signal. My oncologist during our first meeting in January let me know, "You will gain weight, mark my word." Apparently, all that extra calorie talk was intended for patients on other protocols. Upon looking at my now doughy face, I thought, leave it to me. I can't even have cancer and reap the benefit of shedding a few pounds. The nadir of my treatment came in September during the last 2 months of the second protocol of chemo. I found myself giving it over to God when a blood clot had developed near my heart. My best friend, DZ, upon hearing the news, immediately made the four-hour trip to see me. This is a woman who does not believe in lost causes, bad moods, or poor fashion choices. She had heard through family that the toughest and most painful part for me now was that blood had to be drawn from my feet, courtesy of my wimpy arm veins. Not to be daunted by this, DZ burst into the room like an EF4 tornado, wielding a pedicure kit and the most outrageous, screaming red nail lacquer I had ever seen. "If they are going there, we're going to give them a show they won't ever forget," she announced. And we did. We lay in wait for the unveiling several times a day, bit our lips, and turned away giggling as medical techs either attempted to mask their shock or conjured up some compliment for my outrageous toenails. Now, DZ, as a young mom, newly transplanted to country life, once saved her daughter's Easter duck from a rude chicken snake that mistook the pet for dinner. To her daughter's screams of, "Get my ducky, Mommy," she distinguished the tail end of the snake from the business end, grabbed hold, unwound serpent from fowl, and then chopped the thief to bits. When her loved ones are challenged, DZ stares squarely into beady, threatening eyes and says, "I double dog dare ya." And so she did when cancer visited her best friend's door. Armed with both red nail lacquer and laughter, she painted away the pain. And on that fall day, I realized my best Christmas gift had just arrived, albeit a few months late. Family who would slide through icy mountains to see me, and a friend who would make me laugh and stand by me while shamelessly labeling the cancer journey walking abreast with me. On that day, in my mind, a new Christmas song began to play. "Jingle bells, red toenails, laughing all the way.